Good evening, everybody. My name is Eric Ades, and I am the Senior Manager of Homeless Systems Change with the United Way Home for Good. I will be hosting and moderating today's events. Just a couple notes before we begin. One, this event is being recorded, so just want to let folks know from the top. And also, we are going to keep this to a tight hour. So thank you for joining us on time. We'll begin right now and wrap up just before 7. Again, my name is Eric Ades with United Way Home for Good. Welcome and thank you for joining us for the first LAHSA State of Homelessness panel series discussion. Tonight we'll be focusing on homeless outreach. Very excited to be joined by an expert panel to discuss the challenges, the processes, and the goals of homeless outreach in LA County. In terms of flow, we'll be beginning with a presentation from LAHSA Executive Director Heidi Marston, who will kick off the evening's event by presenting on LAHSA's recently released best practices for addressing street homelessness. After that, we'll turn it over to three experts in this field, and I will be facilitating a panel discussion where we'll dig into those best practices and other details regarding outreach in LA County. But before that, I would like to welcome LAHSA Executive Director Heidi Marston, who will be guiding us in a short PowerPoint presentation on the recently released best practices for addressing street encampments. Hi, Heidi.
Thanks so much, Eric. And thank you everyone for being here. We're really excited to host our first panel tonight. Wanted to go through our best practices that were just released by LAHSA earlier this month. And the idea here is to give us a guiding framework as we're looking at how to best manage and work with individuals who are experiencing unsheltered homelessness. What are the best practices we should be grounded in based on the evidence that we have, as well as the experience we've gleaned from operations across the city and the county? Next slide, please. So the best practices document that LAHSA recently published was in coordination with a number of our homeless service providers, as well as our experienced outreach teams across the city and the county. And it really highlights the importance for having a balanced approach that both looks at people where they're residing and encampments that might be large or have particular challenges, and balancing that with the needs of unsheltered individuals who have individual needs that are very high that we need to go work with individually. In all cases, the goal should be to get those individuals on the path to stable and permanent housing. Next slide. When we look at our outreach infrastructure broadly, our system has just over 240 outreach teams, and more than 850 people make up those teams, and all of those teams coordinate. This is a big part of why we've been able to permanently house more than 64,000 people just over the past few years alone. So it's all of the work that our teams do up front to build trust and build relationships with individuals who are unsheltered, living on the street, and helping them figure out what their goals are and supporting them to come indoors. Important to note that ending our homelessness crisis in LA County or anywhere in the country does require a coordinated regional vision that is backed by this one-on-one client-centered engagement and focuses on moving folks indoors. But we do know that there are times when a more intensive effort might focus on a specific encampment as opposed to just the individual. And these are some scenarios and some best practices when that is the case that we want to talk through today. So as many of you know, a year ago when COVID first hit, the CDC instructed all municipalities not to disrupt encampments for fear of accelerating the spread of COVID-19. This naturally made homelessness more visible than ever because a lot of the activities that either whether it's trash pickup or support in keeping encampments in a particular area, those really grew. And it's really become a daily reminder throughout COVID and beyond of the systems that we have in place that have not met the needs of these thousands of unhoused Angelenos. And frankly, until we have more housing, we need to prioritize strategies that address unsheltered homelessness, that are humane, that are trauma-informed, that invest and put the person in the driver's seat of their own response, but really want to continue our focus on the root causes of our homelessness crisis that perpetuate this broken cycle, and making sure that we're using all of our resources whether it's local, state, or federal, to their highest and best use. So we gleaned five tips or key principles that we want to lift up when we're talking about best practices for unsheltered homelessness and addressing street encampments in particular. Again, these are things that we should ground ourselves in across the entire system, recognizing the vast crisis that we have on our street and the multitudes of teams and partners that we have committed to this work. And the first step is to provide ample time to engage with people living in encampments during the transition. So making sure we're going proactively, talking to folks, explaining what the process is and what's going to happen, explaining the timeline for when they might not be able to stay where they are anymore, and giving them ample time to sort out their options. Doing this in a clear and transparent way is critical to making sure that we're not perpetuating trauma or harm, and that we're, again, providing all the options necessary for folks to find alternative locations. Second is to ensure voluntary, client-centered, and trauma-informed care. So this goes back to really putting the individual in the driver's seat of their own pathway. What are the goals they have? Making sure that we're being sensitive to the needs that they have and building the system around them to support them in whatever the next step is. Third is to provide adequate and appropriate and low barrier resources. So what does this mean? It means options for both interim housing, so temporary shelter, or permanent housing if that's available. And it means low barrier really talks about if you have a pet, being able to bring your pet, being able to bring a partner if you have a partner with you, thinking about how we create a no wrong door approach and a system that is flexible and nimble so that people who want to come inside don't feel like they have to give everything up to do it, to meet the mold that the shelter system could have. Fourth, we need to identify an experienced service partner with deep ties to that community and let them lead the effort. Addressing street encampments requires a variety of jurisdictions, a variety of partners, but those service providers who are generally our nonprofits who are in the area are really embedded in those encampments and with those individuals already. So we need to optimize the trust that they've built to make sure that they're leading and pulling through the solution. So this means everything from housing resources to trash pickup to storage, all of that needs to come through the lens of the service provider with them leading the engagement. And finally, establish strong team coordination. It takes many different city, county agencies to do this well. It takes public partners, nonprofit partners to do it well. So having a team that has, again, this no wrong door approach and saying like, we're just gonna figure out how to do the right thing for these folks and we're gonna work together to do it is imperative to the long-term success. Next slide. These are a few recent examples, and you can absolutely get more details in our best practices document that's on the LAHSA website. But these are examples of three different locations, or just a little more than three actually, where we've seen success in taking encampments and moving them indoors. So there was an El Sereno encampment that moved 63 people into two Project Home Key sites, and the retention in those sites remain high. And I want to stress that. It's not just about moving people indoors temporarily, it's about moving them into a place where they feel safe and they want to stay, because if they just come back outside, we've really not solved anybody's challenge. Over a year in late 2019, St. Joseph Center, who's one of our partners, and LAHSA worked at the Venison Globe underpass. We had 16 people move into Project Home Key, 10 into our SRO studio housing portfolio. Some moved into congregate shelters. And again, making sure people have a variety of options of where they wanna go. And we also saw this at the Sepulveda Rec Center, where we helped 11 people moved into Project Home Key within just a 1 week time period. So it can be done. The key is to give enough time and also to make sure that we have adequate resources to offer folks and flexibility so they have a choice of where they go. Next slide. And again, on the caveat side, so focusing the resources without the best practices, here's what we see when these aren't followed. That a lot of people may return to the same place or disperse nearby days or weeks later. So really what we're doing is we're telling folks you can't stay here anymore. They might just go a couple blocks over, or they might try to come back because that's the community and that's the area they know, which is why it's so important we have those services and those shelter and housing options on the back end. We need to focus our limited resources on one encampment Focusing it on one encampment rather draws resources for other people. So one encampment, people know that if you go to these areas, you're going to get help, because at the end of the day, nobody wants to be homeless. And so we need to make sure that we have adequate resourcing so that if those areas do attract more individuals who want support, that we're able to do that. Underplanned encampment operations, so doing things really quickly, not in a coordinated way, can re-traumatize people who've already undergone a lot of physical and mental suffering just by the fact that they're experiencing homelessness. So we don't want fast timelines and our need to kind of move really quickly and sweep something away to impede somebody's progress and to further traumatize them or perpetuate the suffering that they're already undergoing. And we have the ways to do it through these best practices, and following those will lead to much different outcomes. Next slide. I believe that's my last slide. All in all, there's a lot to unpack here, and we have an amazing panel for you today who do this work all the time and can talk more about how this becomes practice. But again, go to LAHSA's website if you want to take a look at the best practices in more depth. Thanks, Eric.
Thank you so much, Heidi. Just to underscore what you mentioned as well, this was a brief slideshow, but you can go to LAHSA.org to see the full document on the best practices for addressing student encampments. So thank you so much, Heidi, for that. At this point, we would like to invite our panelists. I will do some quick bios. One of the challenges with these things is that the folks here on this panel are experts that have been doing this work very successfully for a long time. But I know we want to dive in, so I'll apologize by keeping their bios somewhat brief. But trust me, I've been working with these folks for a long time, and they're incredible at what they do and have been doing it effectively for a number of years. And so I'll introduce folks one by one, and then we'll just dive into the discussion. And just one quick note as well. This is being recorded and will be sent out tomorrow if you registered. It should be made available. So if you know of anybody who was not able to join today, this will be made available at a later time. We'll be sending it out tomorrow. With that being said, let me introduce the panel. And as I do so, feel free to come off camera and then we will dive right into the questions. I'd like to start by inviting Kim Barnett, who's the Associate Director for Access Engagement at LAHSA. She has an extensive background in street-based outreach and capacity building, with 12 years of experience specializing in homeless outreach strategies and development of homeless outreach standards, best practices, community planning, and community engagement. I'd also like to invite Libby Boyce, who's the Director of Access, Referrals, and Engagement at LA County Department of Health Services Housing for Health Program. In her role, she directs the Los Angeles County's Coordinated Street-Based Engagement, Interim Housing, and Enrichment Residential Care Programs. She has spent the last 15 years working on systems and programs that serve people experiencing homelessness. And lastly, I'd like to invite Anthony Ruffin, who has been working in the field of social services for the past 20 years. During this time, he has participated in piloting and implementation of new programs across LA that target the most vulnerable and at-risk homeless persons living on our streets or in hospitals in LA. Specific programs that include the pilot Fuse programs, SIF, and the Hollywood Top 14 and Skid Row projects. Prior to working with the Department of Mental Health, he served as an outreach specialist throughout LA County, serving SPAs 2, 4, 5, and 6. Thank you all so much for joining us this evening. We're going to sort of get into some of the topics and subjects that Heidi brought up in her presentation on the best practices. But before we do so, maybe each of you can take just a couple minutes to start off by discussing sort of the size and scope of outreach in LA County. Each of you represents an agency with significant outreach departments. Can you tell us a little bit about their size, their scope, and sort of the unique focus of your programs and departments? I'll start off by asking Kim.
Hi, good evening, everyone. And I'm so excited to be here, hopefully answer some very relevant questions and share my experience over the last 12 years. So I'm an associate director at LAHSA's Access and Engagement Department. We have teams in every spot. I'm not sure if you can see the map up behind me, but it's across the county, 88 cities, and it is quite a large area to cover. We have different specialties, also other programs that work with specific projects. But for the most part, we're a generalist team that connects folks with the system at large. And we work together with our partners at DHS and DMH to ensure that connections are made to the system as a whole.
Great, thank you, Kim. Anthony.
I'm Anthony Ruffin with the Department of Mental Health, and I work with the home teams, DMH, and we have teams across the county, spots 1 through 8. And our primary focus are people that are gravely disabled on the streets or severely mentally ill that are living on our streets, that have been living on our streets for a very long time. We also collaborate with all of our partners here at LAHSA, Housing for Health, and everybody else. And we just try to be where we could be at countywide to help out in this huge, huge undertaking.
And go ahead and jump in, Libby.
Hi, everybody. Libby Boyce with Department of Health Services, Housing for Health. We have about 80 multidisciplinary teams that include a health provider, a substance use provider, a mental health provider, and case management and people with lived experience. They're throughout all of LA County. Each multidisciplinary team has an area that they are responsible for. And we have a very large collaborative and coordination with our other partners. Right now, because of COVID, we've been weekly meeting to discuss lots of different issues to make sure we can keep our homeless neighbors safe.
Great. Thank you for that, Libby. Okay, and then we're going to start zooming in little by little and get deeper and deeper. So just reflecting on the best practices that Heidi just shared, can you all provide some specific examples of where you've seen any aspect or some of the aspects of the best practices for addressing street encampments that Heidi shared? I think that what really comes alive when you see the best practices are the examples that and the stories that are shared, and sort of an illustration of how these best practices actually lead to successful outcomes. And so I'll go ahead and open it up and see if each of you can share just an example or two on how these best practices have been implemented successfully.
I don't mind starting. So my focus primarily is in areas outside of the city. And a lot of times we are very short resources, including shelters, crisis beds, and things to that nature. So it was kind of a huge blessing to get Project Room Key, you know, in some of the areas that don't have those types of resources. And we were able to be very strategic, working with our proactive teams that had already been in the region and really working with folks that were highly vulnerable, and pretty quickly identify those folks that met the criteria for Project Room Key and get them indoors as quickly as we could. And of course, working with our partners, other agencies, making sure that we did the best with the resource, with the very little resource that we did have available. We wanted to make sure that we were able to get those folks that were going to be, you know, highly impacted if they were sick with COVID. And so it was really just, I can't explain to you, just an enormous feeling of accomplishment, being able to make a referral, get the things that we needed to get done, and be able to actually transport somebody indoors almost, you know, almost sometimes like the next day. And then just being able to, from there, work with them to get them to that next level, whatever that next level looked like for them. So I think that's a prime example that I can share, was a very successful model, and really hoping that we can bring something similar back, or at least bring light to the issue of the need of having additional easy access beds that we can, you know, put our neighbors in to start working on getting some of the things that we need to get done in order to get them permanently housed.
I would just add to what Kim said around COVID has given us an opportunity to bring in significant resources that have been very, very flexible, which is really key for this particular population, because there's no individual is like the next individual. And so there's no, like, if you have so many rules and regulations and hoops that you have to jump through, it becomes very hard to implement and bring people inside. I think it's really important to point out that a lot of the folks who are homeless, you know, most of them do ultimately want to come inside. However, it does take a significant amount of time to build trust and a rapport and to feel as though the person that's working with them on the street from outreach is trustworthy. They have been traumatized a lot. They've lived through a lot of trauma and, you know, they are very, very vulnerable. And so that really can take time. Sometimes it's one day, sometimes it's 6 months, sometimes it's a year. We don't give up on them. I would also say, I think, a very, very important message, which is, you know, people don't want to be moved out of the community where they're homeless, which means that we have to have interim housing and permanent options throughout LA County. And that's one of the barriers that we face regularly. And when they decide to go inside, there's no resource in the area that they're that they have grown up or that they've lived in for 10 years or what have you. So that becomes a very, very big barrier. So we can't impress enough how communities have to embrace unhoused neighbors and help us to create resources within their own community.
Thank you for that. Anthony, anything you'd like to add in terms of best practices as you see them implemented?
Well, it was amazing to me to see that during this COVID outbreak that we had, that we done shelter in place. We put people in PRKs. We opened up QI sites. We started a lunch program on the streets because people were suffering and people couldn't go into stores or anything like that. So we started a lunch program. And it was just an awesome, awesome, awesome thing to watch and be a part of as we kept this community safe foremost. And housing and shelter and stuff was very important, but it was more about keeping the population safe and stopping the spread of COVID throughout our homeless population, because they're super vulnerable. And as we move from that phase into the new phase, I think the PRKs are very, very important. I think the ABH sites are very important. I think Libby Boyce says it best when we need an array of services and options to ask people to have in every community, because without those communities being on board with us, we're just stuck most of the time. And we don't like to be out there doing this work and with our hands tied, and we have super vulnerable people that need to go in.
Thank you for that, Anthony. You know, we're going to dive into this a little bit later, but I think we should just stay on this for now, is that, you know, there were challenges, you know, we all experienced the challenges over the past year and a half during the pandemic, and I think especially those who are living on the streets. It was, you know, a crisis within a crisis within another crisis. But I do think what I've learned from you all, what I've learned over the past year and a half, though, is that there has been, you know, incredible, fantastic things that have been able to happen. What you know, despite those challenges, almost because of the urgency, right? And as we sort of hopefully, knock on wood, you know, transition out of the crisis of the pandemic immediately, but continue to work on the crisis of unsheltered homelessness, you know, I've heard you all reference, and I've seen other people reference sort of what was able to happen. Can you all speak to like what made that happen? And maybe more importantly, like what are the lessons that we can learn around like what helped allow some of that streamlining, for example, to occur, and what we should not lose just because hopefully the immediate crisis of the pandemic is hopefully dissipating.
I'm happy to start. I think what has been really clear is that we have the infrastructure to solve homelessness. We have the tools to solve homelessness. It takes outreach, it takes interim housing, and it takes permanent supportive housing or permanent housing opportunities, an array of those things, obviously. We have the infrastructure doing that between LAHSA, between DMH, between DHS, and our partners. We have so many homeless service providers out there. However, what COVID showed us is the infusion of a significant amount of resources and dollars that were flexible helped us implement like that. Because, we were able to buy motels, we were able to master lease buildings, we were able to lift things up very, very quickly because of those resources. I could go into that deeper, but I think that's generally a high level answer.
Great. I think for me, I'm an outreach person at heart. I started with boots on the ground. And I can say that we all pulled together and it didn't matter. We all just knew we needed to pull together. Our teams didn't stop doing what they were doing, despite the fear of the unknown. And I think that fear and that care and compassion and passion for our homeless neighbors really kind of came out really strong, almost, selfishly, right? Like we were really worried about what we were going to come up against the next day in the morning, or, you know, were we going to be able to find a certain person? Were we going to be able to get testing out? Just a variety of things that we needed to do. Like Anthony mentioned, we got meals. We had to ask people to shelter in place because what was the first thing they said when COVID hit? Shelter at home. Well, a person who's homeless doesn't have a place to shelter in place. So we needed to figure out how we could do that and keep folks safe, not just our homeless neighbors, but ourselves as well, as we were out there and then coming home. And so one of the wonderful things that happened is that DHS was able to bring in doctors and specialists and people that knew and understood what this meant for us and what it was going to look out in the field, and quickly brought all of us together to do a training, to build our capacity, our knowledge, understand, and then have weekly check-ins on what COVID, what the trends of COVID was happening, what to expect, what not to expect, how to wear a mask, how not to wear a mask, you know, how to open a door, how to clean. I mean, you don't even know what hit us, but we all pulled together very quickly, I think overnight, and many, 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 many people worked endless hours to pull everything together to ensure that our homeless neighbors and each other were safe. We relied on each other. We had county partners share their vans, their vehicles, to make sure that we had enough space between our transportation and our staff. Things that you never would have thought about, we somehow pulled together, and it was about just, you know, getting the right people on board and making it happen. And I think those were one of the things that that is really important when things like this happened.
Yeah, I can piggyback on that. A lot of people believe that homelessness services stop at 5 o'clock, but during COVID, it was so many Zoom meetings to 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock at night. And it was so much collaboration going on that even though we were out there, we were able to walk out there with confidence, knowing that we had placement for people. And we got to build relationships with our entire homeless community just from the COVID experience. And I hope that we can continue forward with that, because we went out there and we cared about people and we moved people forward in a day or two. No problem. We got a lot of vulnerable people off the streets. We went into shelters and dispersed shelters due to COVID. We done a lot of work out there, and it took a lot of people, Libby, Boyce, and a lot of other people at the top. And they were on Zoom meetings around the clock and was just giving us the information. And we could get up every morning and go out there with that confidence, knowing that we had another site opening up that may take 500 people.
Anthony, just building off that, I mean, it sounds like on one hand, the immense amount of resources that sort of came above about very quickly, that was one key aspect, right? But it also sounds like, and this gets a little bit on the best practices to your part, Kim, is that sort of a shelter in place allowed outreach workers to work with folks and develop the relationship needed to urgently address people's needs. I also heard, in Heidi's comments on best practices, is things around the time needed to develop relationships. And I think you spoke to that, Libby, a little bit. I think we also heard sort of the risk of what happens when we don't follow the best practices. And so I want to touch on a topic that obviously is very topical and sort of, just be honest, like a little sensitive, but I think it's important that we talk about a little bit, which is, you know, in trying to prevent service disconnection or re-traumatization, I think there's an implication there around sort of what's at risk if we don't sort of lead with services. And so I was wondering if folks can talk about sort of how we minimize or right-size the role of law enforcement during outreach, and what is the risk if we do not do that, and how that might run against sort of these best practices. And so just want to hear your thoughts on that. Maybe I'll start with Libby and then see if Kim and Anthony want to jump in.
Yeah, I mean, sure. I think, you know, the bottom line is that law enforcement are not social workers, they're not mental health professionals, they're not health professionals. And they shouldn't be put in that position, recognizing that there is a lot of criminality going on the streets. However, being homeless is not criminal. So we really need to work with law enforcement to do their job and let us do our job. I think it's something that's very, very important is that most of the people we work with who are unhoused do not trust law enforcement. So that whether or not that's a right or wrong feeling, it doesn't really matter. It's about trying to help people. And so when you look at it from the perspective of, you know, getting out of each of our respective, you know, what we focus on, we definitely can, you know, it's so much more powerful to start and lead with services and get people engaged in services. There are things we can do on the street. If we can't get them into interim housing or they don't agree to go into interim housing or there's not a resource for them at the moment, they're ready to go inside. We can connect them to mental health treatment. We can connect them to substance use treatment. We can connect them to sources of income, which is obviously very important to permanency planning. We can connect them to getting their ID from DMV, which they'll need if they're ever going to sign a lease. So there's lots of work we can do with them that we need to do that actually gets them like feeling good about, oh my God, maybe there is hope. And so you want to start with services. There's absolutely nothing, you know, I'm not saying putting law enforcement down or saying anything like that. I saw some things in the chat. It's just what works here and what's fair and what's humane. The last thing I would say is I would definitely support, a model that if there were plainclothes law enforcement who really were very, very trained in this population and who could help de-escalate situations and help us address crises and work within the teams, I think some of us would probably be open to trying that out.
Yeah, I believe that. And I think most of my friends are
law enforcement. Probably agree too.
Yeah. I wanted to make sure you were speaking a little low. Go ahead.
I'll say I believe, and most of my friends in law enforcement may believe this too, enforcement doesn't work. Enforcement has never worked on any group of people anywhere. But there is room for law enforcement within homelessness. I won't lie about that. But we have so many services out there, like DMH has a street conservatorship pilot program going on that was super successful for people that are severely mentally ill. And we just need the time to build relationships with people and to gain people's trust. And if enforcement of the homeless population, it really just disperses people around the county and it hasn't done us any good. We would like to just work where people are at, have the resources, put them in interim housing or permanent housing, wherever they're at, and work with those people. And sometimes it's gonna take time. It's gonna take time, but we're committed. Like Libby said, we have the leadership to do it. We have the people on the ground that are willing to do it. We just need the resources to get it done.
Thank you for that, Anthony. Oh, go ahead, Kim, sorry.
I think I would just add, for me, I have a little bit of a different experience. I was able to build out a team that works with law enforcement. It's a smaller team, but it's a highly trained team. I agree, I would love for them to be in plain clothes, but this team is highly trained in trauma-informed care, motivational interviewing. They get pretty much all the training that we get, including training with clinicians on their mental evaluation team. I will say my take on this is that recognizing that law enforcement is not a service provider, they're not clinicians, they're not health providers. Right. A lot of times our communities do rely, which agree, Libby, they shouldn't be put in that position, but many of our communities do end up using law enforcement as a first response to our homeless neighbors. So my take on that has always been, let's give law enforcement tools in their tool bag that they can use, be well informed, and know what is appropriate and what does work and what doesn't work.
Thank you for that, Kim. You know, one thing you mentioned, Anthony, and a couple other folks have alluded to in terms of, we know that the infrastructure is successful when there are resources available. And one of the things that I wanted to sort of for you all to touch on, if you can, is sort of, I think we hear a lot about the need to offer services, or offer resources. And sometimes I think we hear sort of permanent and interim housing resources being used interchangeably, or even interim housing being used as sort of this like blanket like topic of like all interim housing, you know, sort of is the same. We know there are a number of different types of interim housing resources. And so I'm wondering if you all can speak to, in detail, sort of the types of specific like resources that are needed to make outreach as successful as possible. Obviously, permanent housing is the goal, but when there's interim housing that's also available, can you speak to sort of like the different types of interim housing that is available, and maybe even the specific types that are needed, but not actually the types of interim housing resources that are available right now for certain of the populations that you work with?
Let me start. So we're all different. We have different backgrounds. We have different barriers. We have different challenges. And so it's not cookie cutter. We need a variety of interim housing. You know, we have people that are with their significant other and might want to be in the same location as the person who's experiencing homelessness, or both are experiencing homelessness and want to be together. We have folks with pets. We have folks with a higher level need, and we have folks that might not need as much services and just need to get, off the street and get back into a kind of a routine to get back on track. So I think that, you know, having a variety of available interim housing beds or shelter beds or crisis beds or a bed that's just no ties attached to it and something that they can have access to feel safe. I can't imagine being out in the street overnight and being in a hopeless situation where you won't have access to something immediately. But a lot of times that is what happens. You know, we have to walk away without being able to place someone right away because there might be a lack of in that particular region. And I think Libby and both Anthony both mentioned we need it across the board in the entire county. Our folks that are experiencing homelessness in a particular region are homeless in that region, and they don't want to leave that area. That is their neighborhood. And so they want to be there.
Yeah, I think when I think about services, I think about services for women that have been sexually abused in their community. And they left their community to come into another community, and they can't go back into their community. I think about an elderly person that got dementia that needs some type of housing. I think about somebody that's severely mentally ill that may need just a stabilization bed for a little while until we're able to get them some type of housing. I think it's people with complex medical conditions out there that need another type of housing. And it all needs to be safe for these individuals. It can't be cookie cutter because we're all human and we all got our different things going on. And if we try to cookie cutter this thing, we're doing the people of Los Angeles a disservice. We can't throw a woman that's been sexually abused in a shelter with men and women in there. We just can't do it. We can't take somebody that's severely mentally ill and throw them into a regular shelter. It just doesn't work. So we need an array of interim housing and supportive housing to deal with people's issues. And I believe we have the leadership, and I believe we have the skill set to get it done. We just need the brick and mortar.
So I'll just add to that. I really appreciate that, Anthony, because I think those examples, you know, bring things home for people. Everybody has a different story. And a lot of folks are very particular on, believe it or not, they're living outside, but they're particular about coming inside and where they come inside. In a lot of cases, they prefer to stay outside if they're not going to be put in interim housing in an area that they feel is their community, or if the site won't take pets, or you could go on and on with this. LAHSA, Department of Health Services, and DMH all have different interim housing programs that serve different clientele. And we work together actually every day and talk about folks that need to, you know, move from one place to the other because they're not a good match for certain site. We have something called air traffic control that we've implemented. And so there's a lot of work that goes into this. I would say the one really big gap, I think, that we're actually opening a new site in October is being able to bring somebody immediately. When they say yes, we bring them immediately inside to a bed where there are people that can really make sure they're stable. We do have crisis beds. LAHSA has a lot of crisis beds, and those, they don't, you know, they don't have to have a reservation, if you will, or be vetted, meaning they don't have to, we don't have to review it and make sure they're an appropriate candidate. But folks come in with all kinds of needs, so we can't bring them inside without making sure we have the staff to meet their needs immediately. So we're opening up a new model that will have a clinic 24/7, a mental health and health clinic. And actually law enforcement will be able to drop people off. People can walk in. I'm hoping we don't get filled up immediately, because I think this is a model that we're really needing in LA County, and hoping we can replicate it if we get additional resources. So it all comes down to resources. Money.
Definitely. Those specialty services too, like we need to be realistic, like folks have different challenges. You know, some folks have mental health, some folks have substance abuse issues or health issues, and those services need to be attached to the interim housing and any housing available, because we need to get folks back on track in a holistic way and do our best to get them reintegrated into the community, whatever it takes, whatever it takes. And a lot of times that whatever it takes is a lot, and we need to make sure that their overall health is well. Some folks go back to work, get training, and all of those different services are definitely things that, you know, as folks transition through or work through the system, they're able to work on that with the appropriate case management and resources.
He says when she talks about trauma-informed care, because every person that I meet that I work with, I always ask myself one question only: what happened to you that made you lay down on the concrete and not want to get back up? Something happened. It just wasn't somebody skipped down the street and said, guess what, I want to be homeless. Something happened, and they need the appropriate housing and appropriate placement to deal with that trauma, if that makes sense.
Definitely does, Anthony, definitely does. I appreciate, and I think we said this from the top, and we should always say it, Libby, we need more resources, we need more housing resources, interim housing resources. So I hope everybody that's joining us knows that, you know, I think everyone on this panel is unified in the sense that we know that what ultimately ends this crisis is housing, both permanent, especially permanent, and also interim resources of a variety of kind. That being said, you know, sort of, I just want to ask you all, you know, fully acknowledging that we don't have resources available across our region, you know, what does, and I think some of you have touched on this already, but just to really send it home, like, what does successful outreach look like when those housing resources aren't readily available. We know that we've talked about time to develop relationships with individuals, to engage with folks, but sort of what are the other activities or meaningful things that are taking place to consider outreach a success, even if housing resources aren't immediately available?
I mean, I know I have good milestones. I mean, the secret to this is being able to build enough relationship with someone to find out, like Anthony said, what happened, right? From the what happened, we call it an assessment, but it's not as impersonal as the word. You know, we start with the conversation, we start building rapport. That in itself is a win. That in itself is successful. One of the things I like to tell my teams is, if you can get somebody in your car, you've crossed a huge barrier, because at the end of the day, we're all strangers. You know, who are we different from the person that harassed them the night before on the street? So, you know, we need to be able to, A, be trustworthy, consistent with the work that we're doing, and continue to come and work on them. Not have an agenda, just really trying to figure out, you know, what do you need? How can I help you today? And we call that proactive outreach. So we build a relationship over amount of time. And things that we can do to be successful is to start to work on the different things and meet folks where they're at. If we're going to push, you know, you need to go here, you need to go there, and it's not something that they're comfortable with at the time, we need to continue to work with them and build enough relationship with them so that, number one, it's not scripted, it's real, it's a legitimate relationship. I think that outreach is one of the most personable, intimate relationships that a client can have with an outreach worker. And when we don't say or do what we say we're gonna do, it breaks, because we're just another person who is letting them down. So transparency is another big thing. Don't overpromise. Be very clear with what we have and what we don't have, what we can do and what we can't do, and do whatever it takes to get that person whole again. And just back to themselves. And that takes a lot of work. And that's not going to happen the first day we come out there. It's going to take some time. And I'm going to have to call Anthony. And I'm going to have to call Libby and see if there's a bed over here. I mean, me and Anthony have each other's cell phone numbers. If we need to get a hold of each other, we will. Because I'm going to need something immediately, because somebody's right there. There's a moment of clarity where folks sometimes have that opportunity to get to that next level, and we need to all be connected. And a lot of ways we do that also in our system. I think Libby kind of mentioned it earlier. It's our traffic control. But the technical word of that is our outreach coordination. And it is a huge undertaking that helps us stay connected. We communicate during regular care coordination meetings. We talk about our clients. We make sure that we know what's out there for our clients, and our teams know each other, and we're working together with those folks. So it's oftentimes we'll get a call and I'll call my team and they're like, I know who that is, and I'm working with this person from this agency, and this is what we've been able to do thus far. And so that is a big key to the work that we're doing, is to make sure that we're coordinated, that our leadership is coordinated, and we have a good relationship across the board, and that our staff equally are coordinated and have a good relationship as well.
I would say, what is outreach, a successful outreach? Sometimes we may not even talk about housing or interim housing. We might just talk about medical and getting a nurse out there to take care of your wounds. It could be your medication, so we can get a nurse or a psychiatrist to come out there and get your prescription for you, and a nurse can come every day and give you your medication. It really doesn't have to be interim housing or permanent housing. It can be other things that people need, ID. It can be a whole slew of other things that are successful outreaches. Stabilizing somebody on medication while they're in the streets. It happens every day. People getting wound care, all of these things that happen every day. People being connected to their PCP. It happens every day. probably 100 times a day with all of these outreach teams. So it's so many things that go on besides just permanent housing and interim housing. And these are the things that the public doesn't see. You might see somebody in a wheelchair and see they got their foot wrapped. They don't know it happened right there on the streets. They don't know that because these teams are so multidisciplinary now that LAHSA can call us in and we can call Housing for Health in and we can all collaborate to help this one person. It's that entwined now. So a successful outreach doesn't always mean interim housing or permanent housing. That's always the goal, but some people are not ready for that yet.
I remember not too long ago, we got a call and it was 5 o'clock already. And you know, that call, we're not 24/7, we're not first responders. And it was a Friday too. And everybody had tried talking to this one particular person who was under duress at this point. And an outreach worker from one of our teams came down there and for whatever reason was able to connect with this particular gentleman a lot more than any of us did. And I asked him, hey, what did you do? He's like, I just asked him how he was doing today. You know, and sometimes because it's 5 o'clock, it's late, we're tired, everybody's, you know, working really hard and different teams already come out. And, you know, we forget that sometimes we just need to make a real connection with somebody and offer care, extend some nice words, you know, and that's another thing is that a lot of times folks connect to different people for different reasons. You know, I'm probably not the best transitional age youth or TAY outreach workers because it just breaks my heart. Everybody breaks my heart, but it a little bit more for that population. But a lot of times I can connect in a different way with that population as well. And so sometimes folks just, you know, it takes a while. And sometimes just getting somebody's name is a successful outreach.
Libby, anything you'd like to add to this specific question around successful outreach when housing resources aren't available?
No, I think they covered it beautifully.
Okay, cool. We're just about winding down, y'all. Thank you so much. We've covered a lot of different topics in this 45 minutes or so. As we wind down, I mean, I think I just want to give you all space, maybe 30 seconds or a minute. You know, we know that street homelessness is something that is one of the most challenging realities in our city, specifically and most importantly for those who are experiencing street homelessness. Like, what is something that you would like to share with our audience with regards to the challenges, processes, goals, or opportunities for outreach in LA County as we close out? What is something you want to leave our audience with as we close out today's event?
I think I would say that mental illness and sickness and all of this stuff that happens in our population, it's a break. It's a break from life. And it's just like a bone. It takes time to heal and it needs to be in the right place to heal. And it's gonna take time. I don't look at people as homeless people. I look at them as people. They're just people. And they went through something and they need some help. We can't shoo them around town. We can't do all of this other stuff to them. We just need to help people and we need the funds and the brick and mortar to do it.
Yeah. I would just say that folks need to embrace solutions within their own communities. I mean, I agree with everything. Obviously, Kim and Anthony have said we work together very closely, so we all sort of have our own little niche, but we are working regularly on trying to come with solutions for the population. And it takes a lot of work. This is definitely, for me, and I've been doing social work since the 80s, and I was somebody who worked in HIV and AIDS, which was not easy. This is the hardest, unhoused individuals is the hardest population to help and to stabilize. And we can't just magically make them go away. That doesn't, you know, there's no way to do that in a humane way. And nor do we want to do that. We do want to get to know everybody, and we do want to hear their story. And we do want to then think about with them and their input, what would meet their particular needs at that moment. And then when we see them in another day, we want to have that, you know, that assessment again. And patience, and really hoping to, you know, bring more resources into LA County, that we fair amount of resources into LA County from the federal government, from the state government, to really do things fast, to be able to buy buildings, to be able to master lease. Anthony says bricks and mortar, which he's right, but we also can master lease and we can do things very quickly. We don't need to build new buildings. So, you know, and I think the other thing I would say just really quick, and then I'll turn it over to Kim. There is a lot going on. I have to tell you, the people that work in this field are amazing. And a lot of people have lost sleep over the last year and a half. I mean, I kid you not, it's been harrowing. And the people who work in this field are absolutely amazing, and they are unsung heroes. Absolutely. And that's really all I have to add.
I'll just close with, you build it, we'll fill it. Let us take care of the homeless outreach. And everyone else needs to take care of their community and make sure that we have enough housing.
Thank you so much for that, Kim. As we close out, just a couple quick notes. Today's video, as well as Heidi's slides, will be emailed out to all of you who registered. And again, the full best practices document is available at the LAHSA website, LAHSA.org. I wanna thank Kim and Libby and Anthony for joining today, and also for their ongoing commitment and successful work that they do every day. You know, like Libby mentioned, there's just so many unsung heroes, specifically during the last year and a half, but ongoing. And we, just to underscore what folks have said, we know that when there are resources available, that the work and the connections that are being done every day, like Anthony mentioned, can and does happen. And so as we continue to push for that, just sending a lot of love and support to, and thanks to the three of you, but also all the outreach workers that you work with, represent all the coordination that is unprecedented that is occurring every day. Thank you all of you for joining today. This was LAHSA's State of the Homeless panel series discussion. It's the first of its kind. The intention is to have these quarterly on a variety of topics, like today's homeless outreach panel discussion. And so thank you all so much for joining us today. Thank you to Libby, thank you to Heidi, Anthony, and Kim. Appreciate you all.